This video is presented to you by Physics for Students.
Mathematics is all around us and has significantly changed the way we look at nature. All the equations which you can see on your screen are important and have served as a pivotal force to understand how the universe works. Newton's second law of motion, Pythagoras' theorem, wave equation, the second law of thermodynamics, the square root of minus one, Euler's formula for polyhedra, and the logarithms. All these are important pillars on which the edifice of physics is built. But perhaps E equals to mc squared is the most popular, widely known equation. It has its own importance, like all these above equations. In this video, we are going to look into the history of E equals to mc squared before Einstein, who and how formulated the concept of c squared. We are also going to look back into the concept of force, the development of thought, and how the law of conservation of energy was developed.
After Albert Einstein formulated this famous equation, the implication of this famous formula was widespread. Even Einstein, perhaps, did not know that his creation would create an atomic bomb responsible for the annihilation of a country, albeit a human race.
If you take the equation and scrutinize, you will find three components: E for energy, m for mass, and c, the speed of light. Why c? It is the c, the speed of light, which is used by the Latin word celeritas, which means light.
We understand how the concept of energy changed over from generations, from Newton, Michael Faraday to Maxwell, and then into nuclear energy. We also have witnessed the development of the concept of mass, further subdivided into neutrons and protons, and thereafter to relativistic mass. But what about c squared? From where does it come? Did Einstein arrive to the conclusion through some preconceived notion? The most interesting part of the equation is that why it is c squared and not c cubed or c7. Well, there are two ways in which we can look around this. One is the mathematical approach, and the second one, which we are going to talk about, is the historical approach. If we take the mathematical way, then we can tell that the v squared comes from the ancient Ionian Pythagoras. Let us quickly have a look into this.
If we take the relativistic mass of a particle as this, then by doing a little bit of simple mathematics, we get this, and doing an integration, we can derive E equals to mc squared. Now you see there is a v squared factor. If we further want to know this, v squared factor comes into play. Then this is called the Lorentz factor, named after the famous physicist Hendrik Antoon Lorentz. So we got some figure like this. The distance that photon travels is speed of light c times the distance t. So vt prime is the dilated time. As per special theory of relativity, speed of light is always constant, so the dilated time times c gives ct prime. So further we get this and then this. And just by applying Pythagoras' theorem, so that v squared term is from the Lorentz factor using Pythagoras. E equals to mc squared, as you see, is related to this. So is it not both v squared and c squared owe something to some parameter?
However, the v squared part also has an interesting point. To explore that, we have to turn the pages of history and go back more than 300 years from now. It was a bitter winter of 1706. Paris was shivering under the cold wind. Preparations were on in full swing to usher the Christmas and the New Year. On the 17th of December, 1706, a baby girl was born who was christened as Emilie du Châtelet. Emilie grew up to be a brilliant physicist, mathematician, and linguist. Her crowning achievement was a commentary on Newton's work of Principia Mathematica. Du Châtelet worked closely with Voltaire, the eminent French philosopher and historian. She and Voltaire had been a long-time companion, and Du Châtelet made significant contributions to elements of the philosophy of Newton in 1738. This helped to popularize the theories and thoughts of Newton. Emily was pondering on the works of Newton and Leibniz, and she found something very interesting. What was she working on? We go back 50 years from that cold, wintry day of Paris. Travel more than 950 kilometers in the town of Leipzig, Germany, to meet a philosopher and polymath, Gottfried Wilhelm Leibniz. The time that we are talking about, the concept of the quantity of motion is already discussed by René Descartes in Principia Philosophi. Descartes believed that God, the general cause of all motion in the universe, preserves the same quantity of motion and rest put into the world at the time of creation. The measurement of this quantity is mv, implied in the statement. We must reckon the quantity of motion in two pieces of matter as equal. If one moves twice as fast as the other, and this in turn is twice as big as the first. By this time, the concept of vis viva was undergoing a controversy. Before we plunge deep into it, let us understand few terminologies. In Latin, vis viva means living force, a term which we now call as kinetic energy. There is also something called vis mortua, dead force. If we take small m orbiting around a body which has a mass big M, and let v be the velocity, r be a distance from big M, and if a be the semi-major axis of the orbit, then the kinetic energy is given by this. This is widely used in astrodynamics and is also referred to as the orbital energy invariance law. This equation is also used in Hohmann transfer, which our Mars orbiter Mangalyaan used to reach the destination. Leibniz was convinced that force was conserved in nature. He argued that mv squared, not mv, was the measure of the force. How did he do that? Leibniz's argument was that the quantity which remains indestructible in nature is not mv, but vis visa, mv squared. In his magnum opus, Monadology writes, "The notion of force is as clear as that of activity and of passivity, for it is that from which activity follows when nothing prevents it."
Leibniz's arguments were against Descartes' measurement of mv. He argued and successfully proved that living force, or vis viva, is measured by mv squared. Acta eruditorum, meaning acts of the erudite, was the first scientific journal of the German-speaking lands of Europe. Founded in 1682 in Leipzig, it got support from Leibniz. He writes in this journal, it is reasonable that the sum of motive force should be conserved in nature and not be diminished, since we never see force lost by one body without being transferred to another or augmented. A perpetual motion machine can never be successful, because no machine, not even the world as a whole, can increase its force without a new impulse from without.
Robert Latta, in his Introduction to Monadology and Other Philosophical Writings, writes, Descartes rightly insisted on the quantity of effect as the thing to be measured, but he conceived the effect in too narrow a way, regarding it merely as an actual motion, that is, the momentum acquired by a body, rather than the work done by the force, the kinetic energy it produces, that is, the vis viva which the body acquires and which Leibniz calls action motrice. The formula for this action motrice is not mv, but mv squared. In the history of science, vis viva, living force, is the early definition of conservation of energy, the first definition of kinetic energy. We will demonstrate this with an example.
Classically, we know that work done is force times distance. Rearranging, we get this. Now we know this. Substituting the values, we get this. So if we make a V equals to 2, then the distance becomes this. So you understand that by doubling velocity quadruples the distance, making V equals to 3 makes D equals to 9 or some factor, and so on. So the momentum, this, was given by Leibniz as this, where m sub I are several masses and V sub I are each velocities. The principle represents the conservation of kinetic energy in an elastic collision, where the total kinetic energy of two bodies after the collision is equal to the total kinetic energy before the collision. This concept was elucidated in his magnum opus, Monadology. In the uniform motions of one and the same body, the action of traversing 2 leagues in 2 hours is double the action of traversing 1 league in 1 hour. The action of traversing 1 league in 1 hour is double the action of traversing 1 league in 2 hours. The action of traversing 2 leagues in 2 hours is 4 times the action of traversing 1 league in 2 hours. This demonstration shows that a moving body that receives double or triple velocity in order that it may produce a double or triple effect in one and the same time receives a quadruple or nonuple action.
Thus, actions are proportional to the squares of the velocities. But most fortunately, this happens to agree with my calculation of force, drawn both from experiments and from the presupposition that there is no mechanical perpetual motion. According to my calculation, forces are proportional to the heights by descending from which heavy bodies might have obtained their velocities, that is to say, as the squares of the velocities. And as there is always conserved the total force for reascending to the same height or for producing some other effects, it follows that there is conserved also the same quantity of motive force, that is, action mortis, in the world. That is to say, to put it definitely, that in 1 hour there is as much action mortis in the universe as there is in any other hour. But at every moment, the same quantity is conserved. And in fact, action is nothing but the exercise of force and amounts to the product of the force into the time. As you can see, 3 important points emerge from Leibniz's statement. Number 1, actions are proportional to the squares of the velocities. Number 2, forces are proportional to the heights. Number 3, squares of the velocities.
So what we establish here is Leibniz's argument on the Cartesian measure of force, establishing a dictum by substituting mv squared for mv. All the above mentioned points brings us close to mv squared, and as you can understand, the speed of an object, roughly speaking, can approach higher and higher and higher until it reaches c, that is the speed of light. Generations later, when Einstein formulated his formula, we forgot our roots, how and where from this c squared got into place.
Willem Jacob Graaf Sande, a Dutch mathematician and natural philosopher, conducted experiments which studied the effects of gravity. He dropped a brass sphere from varying heights into a bed of soft clay. Then, he measured the volume of the impact craters. What he found was astounding. The empirical data showed a non-linear relationship. The force of impact was increasing exponentially. Graaf Sande communicated his results on the impact of falling weights to Emilie du Châtelet. In her Institutions de Physique, from 1740 to 42, du Châtelet combined the practical observations of Graaf Sande to the Leibnizian idea of living force in order to show that the energy of a moving object is proportional to the square of its velocity. She writes, "Now finally, there was a strong justification for considering mv squared as a fruitful definition of energy." Over a period of time, scientists became aware of the mv squared, and hence it became something equivalent to the form of energy. So you know that throwing an object at 20 km per hour would require an energy equivalent to its mass time of 20 km per hour squared. Would it have been a Herculean effort to reach from mv squared to mc squared? This achievement of Emilie is considered as a precursor to the squaring term in E equals mc squared. Indeed, kinetic energy, half mv squared, is the first term in the equation of relativistic kinetic energy, which is this.